Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Complete and Original Norwegian Folktales of Asbjørnsen and Moe by Petter Christen Asbjørnsen and Jørgen Moe. Translated by Tina Nunnally. Foreword by Neil Gaiman. Narrated by Ann Richardson. Foreword by Neil Gaiman. I keep trying to write a measured and sensible introduction to this book, and I keep failing. I keep failing because in order to find out what I think, I pick up the proofs and start to read. Or rather, at this point, to reread and to reread any one of the Norwegian folktales waiting between these covers. And then I'm swallowed by them. I don't read them critically. I don't even put my compare this story from this tradition to this other story that it somehow resembles hat on. I just start to read, and I'm following the adventures of Ashlad, or the girl whose godmother was the Virgin Mary, and I feel satisfied. Someone is telling me a story. I first went to Norway in July 1998. I landed in a tired daze. I had flown to Oslo from Reykjavik, where the sun did not set, and my hotel had no curtains, so I had spent most of the past 3 days awake. I managed a day in Oslo of seeing people, of drinking my tea where Ibsen drank his coffee, and eventually I was taken to my room in the Grand Hotel, where the curtains, lined with black, closed, and in the glorious darkness, I finally slept. I woke refreshed and had days of joy. I was introduced to the art of Theodor Kittelsen, 1857 to 1914, who drew trolls and the Norwegian countryside. Kittelsen was more than an illustrator or a folk artist, but he was not as well known as Arthur Rackham or John Bauer. His trolls made sense. They were as much a part of the world as the trees and the hills. His drawings and paintings felt as though they had paused in their travels for Kittelsen to create their portraits. I learned that Kittelsen was once told that a rival had decided to start painting trolls, and he had been puzzled and upset by this. "How can he draw a troll?" he asked. "He's never seen a troll." The cover of this book features a painting by Theodor Kittelsen. I was driven across the country, from Oslo in the southeast to Bergen in the southwest, passing through the Hardanger Fjord region with its remarkable waterfalls, each a scenic joy. I found myself loving Norway. There was a wildness to the landscape that appealed to me, but it was a restrained wildness. I resolved to return. And return I do when I can. I love Norway. There is a gloom in Norway that creeps out in the oddest places. I delight in the Emanuel Vigeland Mausoleum in Oslo, a candle-lit chapel where people sit in silence and wait for their eyes to become accustomed to the darkness. Then they stare at the naked people and skeletons painted on the shadowy walls. Part of my delight is that the windowless red-brick mausoleum is quietly just another building in a pretty tree-lined residential neighborhood. I encountered Asbjørnsen and Moe's Norwegian folktales sometime in the 1990s and really enjoyed them. They were story types I was familiar with, but there was a focus and a chill, a way of bringing characters on stage, and a canny use of what W.S. Gilbert called corroborative detail, intended to give artistic verisimilitude to an otherwise bald and unconvincing narrative. That engaged me. Still, the translation I read then was a century old, and it creaked at the edges, sometimes. I was already in love with Norse mythology, and one can feel the shadows of the frost giants in some of these stories, or echoes of the tale of Thor and the Loki and the Thialfi of the contest with the giants. Asbjørnsen and Moe also sensed this and drew attention to it. Our sacred mysteries become myths, become folk tales, and frost giants and gods become trolls and heroes, given enough time. In a translation as crystalline and pellucid as the waters of the fjords, Tina Nunnally takes the stories that Asbjørnsen and Moe collected from the people of rural Norway, translates them, and gives them to us afresh. Each story feels honed, as if it were recently collected from a storyteller who knew how to tell it, and who had, in turn, heard it from someone who knew how to tell it. There are a great many sensible people in these stories. Quests are undertaken, disguises adopted, treasures returned with, royalty wed, yes. But there's an ease and a community I love, as well as a way with stories. People seem, many of them, to want to help, and experiencing how information is doled out is a pleasure. Watch the young girl who cannot spin or weave or sew be rescued by three old women who can. All they ask is that she call each of them aunt on her wedding day. I have read dozens of versions of this story, but this is the first to conceal the information about the old women's deformities until the dramatically perfect moment in the story. You will meet youngest sons and foolish farmers, clever women and lost princesses, adventures and fools, just as in any collection of folk stories from anywhere in Northern Europe. But the Norwegian folktales come with trolls, and if Asbjørnsen and Moe did not see them, as Kittelsen did, then they got their stories from people who had, people who had seen the trolls walking in the mist at dawn. Translator's Note. There once were two Norwegian boys who loved listening to stories, especially folk tales. One was named Petter Christen Asbjørnsen, and the other was Jørgen Moe. At the age of 14, the boys met at school in 1827 and formed a lasting friendship that would prove auspicious for both of them. 10 years later, influenced by the folklore work of the Grimm brothers in Germany, Asbjørnsen and Moe set off separately into the mountainous countryside of southern Norway. They were in search of storytellers who might be willing to share the tales that had been passed down in their families for generations. Over the course of more than 20 years, the two young men intermittently continued their work with folk tales, even as they pursued completely different interests. What Asbjørnsen and Moe discovered on these expeditions turned out to be more precious than any hoard of gold and silver, more bountiful than any feast conjured up by a magic tablecloth, and more impressive than a giant 12-headed troll. What they discovered was a cultural treasure trove. The folk tales that Asbjørnsen and Moe wrote down and later collectively published as Norske Folkeeventyr, Norwegian folk tales, would nurture Norway's emerging national identity, and the tales would make their names legendary, not just in their own country, but around the world. Petter Christen Asbjørnsen was born in Christiania, present-day Oslo, in 1812. He was the son of a glazier whose family had roots in the Gudbrandsdal region. As a child, Petter often suffered long periods of illness. In his father's workshop, he would listen to local shopkeepers and tradesmen recounting traditional legends and tales. He read widely and had a keen interest in nature, which prompted him to take frequent hikes in the nearby countryside. After he finished school, Asbjørnsen spent 3 years in Romerike as a private tutor before going on to study natural history and medicine. During these years, he laid the groundwork for a literary outpouring that would one day include not only the famous folktale collections, but also Christmas stories, regional legends, scientific treatises. He introduced Darwin's ideas to Norwegian readers in an article published in 1861, and even a seafaring novel. Eventually, Asbjørnsen focused his considerable energy and zeal on zoology, receiving several grants to conduct research along both Oslo Fjord and Hardanger Fjord. There, he discovered a new type of starfish, which he named Brisinga endocognomos, after the necklace called Brisingamen, that belonged to the goddess Freya in Nordic mythology. Later, he turned to forestry and studied in Germany, where he met Jakob and Wilhelm Grimm. On returning to Norway, Asbjørnsen was appointed chief forester in Trøndelag. He also became an expert on Norwegian peat production, and both vocations provided him with a steady income for the rest of his life. He died in 1885. Jørgen Moe took an entirely different course in his life. He was born in 1813 in the Norwegian municipality of Hulle, in the southern region of Ringerike. His father was a prominent landowner and farmer who often represented the area in Stortinget, Norway's parliament. He was determined that his son should study law. But Jørgen had no interest in that field. His passions were literature and the philosophy of aesthetics. Eventually, he would become a respected author and write some of Norway's most beloved poems and songs, including the classic children's story, I brunnen og I skjæret, in the well and in the lake. In 1832, recognizing that his literary interests were unlikely to provide him with a living, Moe made the practical decision to study theology. 7 years later, he passed his exams, having weathered a broken engagement and a debilitating period of depression. He wasn't yet ready to become an ordained Lutheran pastor and settle into clergyman duties. Instead, he supported himself by taking various teaching positions as he continued to publish poetry and ballads in the national romantic style. During this period, Moe was corresponding with his longtime friend, Petter Christian Asbjørnsen, about topics such as the retelling of traditional tales by the German author Ludwig Tieck. More significantly, they discussed the groundbreaking work of Jakob and Wilhelm Grimm. The brothers' emphasis on the historical and cultural importance of folklore reignited the enthusiasm the two friends had always felt for Norwegian folktales. The influence of the Grimm brothers led Moe to write an extensive introduction to the second edition of Norske Folkeeventyr, published in 1852. The first half of Moe's introduction was a lengthy commentary on folktale scholarship in diverse cultures around the world. The second half, now translated into English for the first time and included in this book, presents a fascinating look at Moe's own views of the Norwegian tales, and in particular, how they relate back to the sagas and Norse mythology. Moe wrote, "Like the dwarves Austri, Vestri, Nordri, and Sudri in the Eddas, the winds are personified in the tales about the boy who went to the north wind and demanded the flower back, Soria Moria Castle, and East of the Sun and West of the Moon." In the story Lillekort, the title character is given a ship that is one and the same with the ship called Skidbladnir of Norse mythology. And you might even deduce that the hunchbacked and one-eyed old woman is reminiscent of the god Odin, whose divine power is manifested in the description of the ship. Asbjørnsen and Moe decided to remove this scholarly introduction from future Norwegian editions in favor of allowing the tales to speak for themselves to readers of all ages. In 1850, Moe lost the research grant that had offered him some measure of financial security, and the following year he married. It was finally time for him to assume his pastoral duties in order to provide for himself and his family. He held positions in Bragernes and Vestre Oker, and in 1876 he was appointed bishop of the Kristiansand diocese. He was known as a masterful preacher, a conservative theologian, and a man who always showed great kindness and devotion to his congregations. Throughout his long career, Moe continued his literary projects, although his clergyman obligations meant that he had to give up further folklore research. In 1872, he became a member of the Royal Norwegian Society of Sciences and Letters. He died in 1882. The publication of Asbjørnsen and Moe's Norske Folkeeventyr began in December 1841 with the appearance of a slim 96-page unbound pamphlet. The pamphlet garnered praise from both Petter Andreas Munk, the influential historian and saga translator, and Johann Sebastian Wellhaven, the respected author and literary critic. This positive reception motivated the two young folklorists to continue their expeditions throughout southern Norway, usually going to separate regions in order to collect the most tales for pamphlets. In 1843, a volume of 41 tales was published in Christiania by Johan Dahl, followed in October 1844 by a second volume of 12 tales by the same publisher. Together, these two volumes would make up the first edition of Norske Folkeeventyr. 8 years later, in 1852, a second edition was published that expanded the number of tales to 58, and then finally, in 1866, the third edition included 60 tales, with Asbjørnsen and Moe each adding one new tale. In his foreword to this second edition, Asbjørnsen explained their methodology. The very effort of persuading the nation's storytellers to make themselves known, openly and without reservation, requires approaching them in a unique manner. A direct appeal does not get you far, and even the promise of payment is wasted on the best of them, meaning those who have a love for what has been handed down to them. To convince such people to remove the lock from their lips, it is necessary to possess an innate tact, which is then further developed through practice and by studying the Norwegian people. But above all, it is necessary to allow a true love for these traditions to shine through. You need not bother with any dissembling, for it will have either no effect or the opposite effect in terms of what you wish to achieve. When Asbjørnsen and Moe set off for Norway's deep mountain valleys, they took with them their great love for the traditional tales they had already heard from family, friends, and local storytellers. They were energetic, passionate, and determined young men who wanted to discover and record stories that were part of their cultural heritage. As Moe explained in his introduction to the 1852 edition, although the tales may be similar in content to stories from other nations, they are nevertheless not the same. They are clearly manifestations of our country's unique setting and commonly shared conditions. In this sense, the setting, the entire stage on which a simple and ordinary story is played out, while at the same time a colorful and richly varied imaginary performance takes place, is always the familiar mountainous landscape of Norway. We see the dense forests with the small green clearings where you can rest after a journey, the ridge after ridge of mountains that you must traverse, the heights where Doppelbund is raised, the big high mountain that casts a shadow over the king's courtyard, the steep mirror-smooth slope that Ashlad has to ride up, the sheltered cleft where the old woman sits and lures in the weary herder. These and thousands of other small details tell us that we are at home in Norway, no matter how amazing the events may be that capture our attention. Just as momentous as their decision to collect the tales was their resolve to not write them down in the distinctive dialects of each region. Instead, they gave the tales a consistent literary voice, while maintaining the vitality and immediacy of oral storytelling. They opted for a syntax and word choices that were clearly Norwegian at a time when the Danish language still weighed heavily on literary and linguistic endeavors in Norway. Asbjørnsen and Moe were initially criticized for dramatically veering away from the established and more formal conventions deemed necessary for written texts. Yet their volumes of folktales soon sparked a national surge of interest in what was uniquely Norwegian. Asbjørnsen wrote in the foreword to the second edition, "At the time we began our collections, there were undoubtedly few in Norway who regarded the tales as anything more than mere nursery room chatter, with most viewing our attempt to collect and publish them as childish foolishness. We think that we have contributed in some manner to a recognition of what is meritorious about bringing to light everything that belongs to the nation." Certainly most Norwegians would agree. Generations of Nordic writers, artists, illustrators, and musicians have been influenced by the stories that Asbjørnsen and Moe collected and published in the mid-1800s. Generations of children have grown up shivering with awe and anticipation as they read tales about magic spells, mountain-sized trolls, resourceful princesses, and the intrepid young boy named Ashlad. Nearly 180 years after the publication of the first slim volume, Norske Folkeeventyr is still considered a national treasure. Countless editions have been published in Norway and the rest of Scandinavia, and the names Asbjørnsen and Moe have become synonymous with this sparkling example of Norway's proud cultural traditions. It didn't take long for the work of Asbjørnsen and Moe to make its way to other parts of the world, thanks to early translations. The first English translation was published in 1859 under the title Popular Tales from the Norse. It was based on the 58 tales presented in the second edition of Norske Folkeeventyr and included a lengthy introduction by the translator, Sir George Webb Dasent, 1817-96. Dasent had developed an interest in Nordic tales and mythology after meeting Jakob Grimm in Stockholm. He went on to publish many translations from the Scandinavian languages and was especially known for his English renderings of Icelandic sagas. What is most remarkable about this first translation is that it has remained the only English translation to include the initial collection of all 58 folktales. When Asbjørnsen and Moe added two tales to their third edition, a total of 60 stories then became the standard number in later Norwegian volumes. Subsequent English translations have presented only a handful of stories. Even the publication of Norwegian Folktales in 1960, translated by Pat Shaw and Carl Norman, contains only 35 tales, and less than a third of these are from the original Norske Folkeeventyr. Several years ago, Eric Anderson, editor at the University of Minnesota Press, mentioned to me that he had long wanted to publish a new translation of the folktales collected by Asbjørnsen and Moe. I have always loved translating classic literature, so I was intrigued by the idea. But I was busy with other books, and the timing wasn't right. In 2017, generous funding opportunities from Norway and an opening in my work schedule suddenly made the folktale project feasible. Before I agreed to take on what would be a very challenging endeavor, I decided to look at several stories translated by Dasent. His popular Tales from the Norse has been reprinted many times, even quite recently, and I wanted to be sure that there was a need for a new English translation. I quickly concluded that although Dasent's translation may have been suitable for a 19th-century audience, it would not appeal to modern-day readers. The style is uneven and inconsistent, there are misunderstandings, and the wording seems clumsy and old-fashioned. Certain details are more identifiable as British rather than Norwegian. Dasent chooses bannock instead of lefse, boots instead of ashlad, and, strangely enough, he describes Norway's majestic mountains as hills. Of greatest concern is the loss of the storytelling voice that Asbjørnsen and Moe were so careful to instill in the Norwegian. Accuracy is essential in any translation, but just as important is capturing the voice or tone of a literary work. The translator must try to convey in her own language the rhythm and cadence, what I call the music of the original. This is one of the most difficult tasks a translator must accomplish. Asbjørnsen and Moe adopted a clear and deceptively simple narrative style that was meant to be read aloud. They used repetition and alliteration to mimic the tradition of oral storytelling. The tales are filled with humor, rhymes, and an abundance of detail. Sometimes they choose words specific to the old farming way of life in Norway, using terms no longer common today. Payments are made in daler and skillinger, reflecting the monetary system of the time. And there's a lot of dialogue, which has to sound natural, not too archaic and not too modern. Throughout the stories, the towering mountains and dense forests of the Norwegian landscape are always vividly present. I would need to consider all these stylistic issues, but clearly it was time for a new English translation of Asbjørnsen and Moe's Norwegian folktales. I happily delved into the project. I wanted to go back to the original source, so I chose to work from the fourth Norwegian edition. This turned out to be doubly daunting because the book was printed in the old Gothic script with almost no paragraph markings. With each of the previous editions, Asbjørnsen and Moe had made changes to the Norwegian language in terms of syntax, spelling, and word choice. The fourth edition was the last time the two friends decided together which revisions should be made to the text. Subsequent revisions, occasionally even in the storyline, were largely made by Moe's son, Moltke. Later Norwegian editions continued the process begun by Asbjørnsen and Moe of making the language more Norwegian. I grew up in a Finnish-American family, and from an early age I was familiar with the trolls and the elves, tontu, that inhabit the forests of Finland. I was also familiar with the more benign Danish elves, called nisse. My siblings and I used to scare ourselves silly by looking at John Bauer's illustrations in our mother's book of Swedish fairy tales. As a child, I read Tove Janssen's Moomin books, Alice in Wonderland, the fairy tales of Hans Christian Andersen, and many other books filled with magic and enchantment. I read a tame version of the Three Billy Goats Gruff and a few other Norwegian stories. And of course, I'd seen pictures and carvings of Norwegian trolls. But I had never actually read Asbjørnsen and Moe's Norske Folkeeventyr. What a joyous discovery! All those gigantic trolls are both ferocious and strangely endearing. They lumber through the dark forests and hunker down inside the mountains. Some of the trolls bellow and roar, while some of them wheedle and whine. They matter-of-factly lop off heads, turn princes into stone, and whisk folks away into the mountains. Yet none is a match for the bold and inventive Ashlad, who has no compunction about chopping off troll heads, even 12 at a time. As Moe explained in his introduction to the second edition, "Everywhere we can see, as in the sagas, the direct and ruthless way in which everything is described, a means of expression that stems not from cruelty but from naivete and lack of guile. We find the same bold and magnificent sense of humor that, like the hero in a German tale, seems to be presented in order to teach fear. We discover everywhere the pure epic narrative style whose sole purpose is the joy of observation. Hence, it dwells as much on the sorrowful and terrible as it does on the bright and cheerful, but it rarely, if ever, reveals the disposition of the narrator as events unfold. There are observant princesses who know the secrets to wielding a magic sword, and servant girls who use their wits to marry a prince. A sister persists in an impossible task to rescue her brothers. A brave maiden rides the north wind to save the prince who had been turned into a polar bear. There are talking horses, clever foxes, and steadfast roosters." I was astonished by the lively humor and the sheer variety of the stories. Some show the virtues of kindness, the husband's daughter and the wife's daughter, or integrity, the honest 4 schilling coin. Some explain aspects of the natural world, why the bear has a stump of a tail, and some are just plain odd, the rooster and the hen. Translating these 60 tales into English has been an honor and a delight. I hope that many more generations of readers, both young and old, will now enjoy the treasure trove that Norwegian storytellers long ago entrusted to Petter Christian Asbjørnsen and Jørgen Moe, those two young men who loved folk tales. Tina Nunnally, April 2019, Albuquerque, New Mexico. About Ashlad, who stole the troll's silver ducks, coverlet, and golden harp. There once was a poor man who had 3 sons. When he died, the two older sons were about to set off into the world to try their luck, but they refused to take the youngest with them.
"You,"
they said, "the only thing you're good for is sitting here and digging in the ashes." "Then I suppose I'll have to go alone," said Ashlad. The two sons left. They came to a royal palace, and there they found jobs as servants. The first was hired by the stable master, and the other by the gardener. Ashlad also set off. He took along a big bread trough, which was all they had left from their parents, though his brothers had no use for it. The trough was heavy to carry, but he didn't want to leave it behind. After he'd walked for a while, he too arrived at the royal palace and asked to be hired as a servant. They told him that they had no need for him, but he pleaded so sincerely and politely that finally he was allowed to go to the kitchen. There he could carry firewood and water for the kitchen maid. He was hard working and clever, and it didn't take long before everyone grew quite fond of him. But his two brothers were lazy, and for that reason they were beaten and received only meager wages. They grew jealous of Ashlad when they saw that things were going much better for him. Right across from the royal palace, on the other side of the lake, lived a troll who had 7 silver ducks that swam about in the water and could be seen from the palace. The king had often wished he might own those ducks, so the two brothers said to the stable master,
"Our brother has boasted that if he wanted to, he could get those 7 silver ducks for the king."
As you might expect, it wasn't long before the stable master told the king about this. The king then summoned Ashlad and said,
"Your brothers say that you can get the silver ducks for me, so that is what you must do."
"That's not something I've thought or said," replied the boy.
But the king insisted.
"You did say it, and you shall do it," he said.
"All right," said the boy. "Seeing as I have no choice, give me a 1/4 barrel of rye and 1/4 barrel of wheat, and I will try."
He was given the rye and wheat, which he put in the bread trough that he'd brought from home. Then he got in the trough and rowed across the lake. When he reached the opposite shore, he began walking along, scattering the grain here and there. Finally, he managed to lure the ducks into the trough, and then he began rowing back as fast as he could go. When he reached the middle of the lake, the troll appeared on shore and caught sight of him.
"Are you making off with the 7 silver ducks that belong to me?"
"Yes, I am," said the boy.
"Will you be back this way again?"
asked the troll.
"That may be," said the lad.
When he brought to the king the 7 silver ducks, everyone at the royal palace grew all the more fond of him, and even the king said it was a job well done. But his brothers grew more resentful and envious. They decided to tell the stable master that Ashlad had boasted that if he wanted to, he could bring to the king the troll's coverlet, which had a silver pane and a golden pane, and another silver pane and golden pane. Once again, the stable master didn't hesitate to report this to the king. The king then told the boy what his brothers had said, that he had boasted he could get the troll's coverlet with the silver and golden panes. So that was what he had to do, or else he would lose his life. Ashlad replied that this was not something he had thought or said, but it did no good. So he asked for 3 days in which to consider the matter. When the time was up, he again rowed across the lake in the bread trough, and then walked back and forth on shore, keeping an eye out. Finally, he saw that those who lived inside the mountain had come out to hang up the coverlet to air. When they were safely back inside the mountain, Ashlad grabbed the coverlet and began rowing back as fast as he could go. When he was in the middle of the lake, the troll appeared and caught sight of him.
"Are you the one who took my 7 silver ducks?"
shouted the troll.
"Yes, I am," said the boy.
"And are you now making off with my coverlet with 1 silver pane and 1 golden pane and another silver pane and golden pane?"
"Yes, I am," said the boy.
"Will you be back this way again?"
asked the troll.
That may be, said the boy.
When he got back with the golden and silver coverlet, everybody grew even more fond of him than before, and he became the king's personal servant. That made his two brothers even more resentful. To seek revenge, they said to the stable master,
Our brother has now boasted that he can get for the king the golden harp the troll owns. It's a harp that will make everyone happy when they hear it, no matter how sad they might be.
The stable master reported this at once to the king, who said to the boy,
Since you said that, you must do it. If you succeed, you shall have the princess and half my kingdom. But if you don't succeed, you shall lose your life.
That is not something I have either thought or said, replied the boy. But I suppose there is nothing to be done about it, and I will have to try. I will need 6 days to consider the matter.
He was granted the 6 days, but when they were up, he had to set off. He put in his pocket a nail, a birch twig, and a candle stump, and rode across the lake. Then he crept about, walking back and forth. After a while, the troll came out and caught sight of him.
Are you the one who took my 7 silver ducks? Shouted the troll.
Yes, I am, replied the boy.
Are you also the one who took my coverlet with the silver and the golden panes? Asked the troll.
Yes, I am, said the boy.
Then the troll grabbed him and took him inside the mountain.
So, daughter of mine, he said, I've got him now, the one who took my silver ducks and my coverlet with the silver and golden panes. Put him in the sty to fatten him up. When we slaughter him, we'll invite all our friends.
She gladly did so at once. She put Ashlad in the sty where he stayed for 8 days, and was given the very best food and drink he could ever wish for, and as much as he wanted. When the 8 days were up, the troll told his daughter to go out and cut into the boy's little finger to see if he was fattened up. So she went over to the sty.
Give me your little finger, she said.
Instead, Ashlad stuck out the nail, which she tried to cut.
Oh, no, he's still as hard as iron, said the troll's daughter when she went back to her father. We can't take him yet.
After another 8 days, the same thing happened, only this time Ashlad held out the birch twig.
He's a little better, she said when she went back to the troll, but he'll be as tough as wood to chew.
After 8 days, the troll again told his daughter to go and see if he was fattened up.
Give me your little finger, said the troll's daughter when she got to the sty.
This time Ashlad held out the candle stump.
Now he's ready, she said.
All right, then, said the troll. I'll be off to invite our guests. In the meantime, you must slaughter him, then fry half of him and boil the other half.
After the troll left, his daughter set about sharpening a big, long knife.
Is that what you're going to use to slaughter me? Asked the boy.
That's right, said the troll's daughter. It's not sharp enough, said the boy. Why don't you let me sharpen it? Then it will be easier for you to take my life.
So she let him have the knife, which he began honing and sharpening.
Let me try it on your braid, said the boy. I think it's ready now.
She agreed to let him do that, but the instant he grabbed hold of the troll daughter's braid, he yanked her head back and cut it right off. Then he boiled half of her and fried the other half and set the food on the table. After that, he put on her clothes and sat down in the corner. When the troll came home with the folks he'd invited, he asked his daughter, for he thought it was her, to come and eat dinner with them.
No, replied the boy, I don't want any food. I feel very grumpy and sad.
Well, you know what to do about that, said the troll. Get the golden harp and play it.
Yes, but where exactly is it? Said the boy.
You know very well where it is. You were the one who played it last.
It's hanging over there, above the door.
The boy didn't have to ask twice. He took down the harp and played it as he walked in and out of the house. All of a sudden he pushed the bread trough out into the water and began rowing so fast that the water surged around the trough. After a while, the troll thought his daughter had been gone a long time, and he went outside to see what had become of her. Then he saw the boy in the trough far, far away on the lake.
"Are you the one who took my 7 silver ducks?" shouted the troll.
"Yes," said the boy.
"Are you the one who took my coverlet with the silver panes and golden panes? Was that you, too?"
"Yes," said the boy.
"And have you now taken my golden harp?"
"Yes, that I have," said the boy.
"But didn't I just eat you?"
"No, it was your daughter you ate," replied the boy.
When the troll heard that, he grew so angry that he burst. Then Ashlad rowed back to shore and gathered up a big heap of gold and silver, as much as the trough could carry. When he got back to the royal palace with the golden harp, he was given the king's daughter and half the kingdom, just as the king had promised. But he treated his brothers well, for he thought that everything they'd said was only because they'd wanted the best for him.
The Yethrud Bird.
Back in the day when our Lord and Saint Peter wandered here on earth, they once came upon a woman who was baking. Her name was Yethrud, and she wore a red cap on her head. Since they had been walking for a long time and they were both hungry, our Lord asked her ever so politely if he might have a bite of lefse. Oh, yes, he certainly might. She broke off a stingy little piece of dough and rolled it out. Yet it grew so big that it covered the entire griddle. No, the lefse was too big now, and he couldn't have any of that one. She broke off an even smaller piece, but when she rolled it out and spread it on the griddle, that lefse also grew too big. He couldn't have any of that one either. For a third time, she broke off an even smaller piece, a teeny tiny bit. But again, the lefse was much too big.
"So I have nothing to give the two of you," said Yethrud. "You might as well go on your way without having even a taste, for all the lefse I make is too big."
Then our Lord grew angry and said, "You have treated me so badly that you will be punished in this manner. You will become a bird, forced to find your dry nourishment between bark and wood, and you will receive something to drink only when it rains." Hardly had he uttered the last word than she turned into the Yethrud bird, a black woodpecker, and flew from her breadboard straight up through the chimney. Even today you can see her flying around, wearing her red cap, her body completely black from the soot in the chimney. She picks and pecks at the trees in search of food, and she whistles for rain, for she is always thirsty and waiting for something to drink. The Griffin. There once was a king who had 12 daughters, and he was so fond of them that he always kept them close. But every afternoon, while the king slept, the princesses would go out for a stroll. One day, when the king was having his afternoon nap and the princesses had gone out, they suddenly disappeared and did not return. Then a great sorrow came over the whole country, but the king was the most sorrowful of all. He sent out word to all the churches, both in his own kingdom and abroad, saying that he was searching for his daughters. And he ordered the bells to toll for them everywhere in the land. But the princesses were gone, and gone they stayed. No one knew where they were. It was thought that they must have been taken inside the mountain, and it wasn't long before this was rumored far and wide, both in towns and in villages and in foreign realms as well. Then the rumor also reached a king in a faraway land who had 12 sons. When the princes heard about the 12 royal daughters, they asked to be allowed to set off to search for them. The king was reluctant to grant his sons permission to leave, for he was afraid he might never see them again. But they fell to their knees before the king and pleaded for so long that he finally relented and let them set off. He outfitted a ship for them and assigned the Red Knight to be their helmsman, for he was a skilled seaman. They sailed around for a long time and went ashore in all the lands they neared, searching for and inquiring about the princesses, but no one had seen or heard from them. By now, the princes had been sailing for a few days short of 7 years. One day, a big storm blew in, and the weather was so foul that they thought they would never see land again. Everyone had to work very hard, and no sleep was possible for as long as the storm lasted. On the third day, the wind subsided, and suddenly everything was utterly still. They were all so worn out from the work and the terrible weather that they fell asleep at once. But the youngest prince was restless and couldn't sleep. As he walked back and forth on deck, the ship came to a small island, and on the island was a little dog running about and barking and whining at the ship as if it wanted to come on board. The prince called and called and whistled to the dog, which barked and whined all the more. He felt bad that the dog would have to stay there and die. He thought it must have come from a ship that had gone down in the storm. Yet he didn't think he could help the dog, for he wasn't sure he was capable of putting the rowboat in the water. The others were all sleeping so soundly that he didn't want to wake them just because of a dog. The weather was now clear and calm, and the prince thought to himself, "You could go ashore and save that dog." He decided to put the rowboat in the water, and it was easier than he'd expected. He rowed ashore and went over to the dog, but every time he reached for it, the animal would leap aside. The dog kept on like that until, before he knew it, the prince had entered a big, splendid castle. Once inside, the dog changed into a lovely princess, and on the bench sat a man so big and so ugly that the prince was truly frightened.
"You have no need to be afraid," said the man.
Yet the prince grew even more frightened at the sound of the man's voice.
"I know full well what it is you want. You and your brothers are 12 princes, and you are searching for the 12 princesses who disappeared. I know where they are. They are with my master. There they sit, each on a golden chair, each of them picking the lice from one of his heads, for he has 12 of them. You have been sailing for 7 years, but you will have to sail for 7 more before you find them. You're welcome to stay here," he said, "and I will give you my daughter. But first you will have to kill my master, for he treats us all harshly, and we have grown tired of that. When he's dead, I will be king in his place. But let's see if you can wield that sword," said the troll.
The prince reached for the old and rusty sword that hung on the wall, but he could hardly budge it.
"Take a swig from this flask," said the troll.
After he did that, the prince was able to move the sword. After another swig, he could lift it, and after yet another swig, he could swing the sword as easily as a stick for turning lefse.
"When you get back on board," said the troll prince, "you must hide the sword in your bunk so the Red Knight won't see it. He's not skilled enough to wield the sword, yet he will be furious with you and try to kill you. When there are 3 days short to 7 more years," he went on, "the same thing will happen again. Terrible weather will bring a storm upon you, and after it passes, all of you will be very sleepy. Then you must take the sword and row ashore. You will come to a castle protected by all sorts of guards, wolves and bears and lions. But don't be frightened of them. They will all fall at your feet. When you enter the castle, you will see my master sitting in a splendid chamber, gilded and bejeweled. He has 12 heads, and the princesses each sit on a golden chair, picking the lice from one of his heads.
And that is not work they enjoy, let me tell you. You must hurry up and chop off one head after the other. If he wakes up and sees you, he will swallow you alive.
The prince went back on board the ship, taking the sword and keeping in mind what he'd been told. The others were still asleep, so he hid the sword in his bunk to make sure that neither the Red Knight nor anyone else would see it. Now the wind picked up again and he woke the others. He told them he didn't think it was right for them to sleep any longer, for they now had such a good wind. No one had noticed that he'd been gone. When it was 3 days short of 7 years, everything happened just as the troll had said. Terrible weather brought a storm that lasted for 3 days, and when it passed, they were all so tired from working hard that they lay down to sleep. But the youngest prince rowed ashore. There the guards fell at his feet, and he was able to enter the castle. When he entered the chamber, he found the big troll sitting there, asleep, just as the troll prince had said. And the 12 princesses each sat on a chair, picking the lice from his heads. The prince motioned for the princesses to move out of the way. They pointed at the troll and motioned for the prince to turn around and leave, but he kept on gesturing for them to move out of the way, and then they understood that he wished to rescue them. Quietly, one by one, they moved aside. Quickly he chopped off all the heads of the Troll King until blood gushed out in a great torrent. After killing the troll, the prince rowed back to the ship and hid the sword. He thought that he'd done his share. He wouldn't be able to remove the body, and he wanted the others to offer a little help. So he woke them up and said it was a shame they should be lying there asleep while he'd found the princesses and rescued them from a troll. The others laughed at him and said he'd probably been asleep just like them. He'd probably slept even more soundly and merely dreamed he was such a man. If anyone was going to rescue the princesses, it would more likely be one of them. Then the youngest prince told them everything that had happened, and they agreed to go ashore with him. As soon as they caught sight of the torrent of blood and saw the castle and the troll and the 12 heads and the princesses, they realized he'd been telling the truth. Then they helped him throw the heads and the body into the sea. Everyone was happy, yet no one was happier than the princesses, who no longer had to sit and pick lice off the troll all day long. Of all the gold and precious items to be found in the castle, they took as much as the ship would hold. Then they went on board, both the princes and the princesses. After they had sailed a good distance out to sea, the king's daughters said that in the midst of their joy they had forgotten their golden crowns, which were kept in a cupboard. They would dearly like to have them. When none of the others offered to go back to get the crowns, the youngest prince said, "I've already ventured so much that I can certainly go back to get the crowns, too. Just take down the sails and wait for me to return." His brothers agreed to do that. But when the youngest prince had gone so far that they could no longer see him, the Red Knight spoke up. He wanted to be the foremost of them all and claim the youngest princess for himself. He said that it would do no good to lie at anchor and wait for the prince, for surely they realized that he would never come back. They knew, he said, that the king had given him, the Red Knight, power and authority to sail wherever he liked. Now he told them to say that he had rescued the princesses, and if anyone said otherwise, that person would lose his life. The princes didn't dare do anything except what the Red Knight wanted, and so they sailed off. In the meantime, the youngest prince rowed ashore, went up to the castle, and found the cupboard with the golden crowns. He rolled and trundled the cupboard down to shore and lifted it into the boat. But when he rowed to the spot where he should have seen the ship, it was gone. It was nowhere in sight, and he realized what must have happened. It would be no use to try and go after the ship, so he had to turn around and row back to shore. Of course, he was afraid to spend the night alone in that castle, but there was no other shelter.
He mustered his courage, locked all the doors and gates, and went to lie down in a room where a bed had been made up. But he was frightened. He grew even more fearful after he'd lain there for a while and the walls and roof began to creak and groan, as if the whole castle was about to split apart. Suddenly, something landed next to his bed, like a load of hay. Then it was quiet again. A moment later, he heard a voice saying,
"Don't be afraid. I've come to your aid. I am the Griffin."
"As soon as you wake up in the morning," said the Griffin, "you must go to the storehouse and get me 4 barrels of rye. That's what I need for my breakfast, or else I can't do a thing."
When the prince awoke, he saw an unbelievably big bird with a feather at the back of his neck that was as thick as a medium-sized beam. The prince went out to the storehouse to get 4 barrels of rye for the Griffin. After the bird had eaten, he asked the prince to hang the cupboard with the golden crowns on one side of his neck, and then take as much gold and silver to counter the weight, and hang that on the other side. Then he told the prince to climb onto his back and hold on tight to his neck feather. The bird took off, whooshing through the air, and it didn't take long before they flew near the ship. The prince wanted to go on board to get the sword. He was afraid someone might see it, and the troll had told him this must never happen. But the Griffin told him to leave it be for now.
"The Red Knight won't see it," said the bird, "but if you go on board, he'll try to kill you. He wants to have the youngest princess for himself, though you needn't worry about her. She places a bare sword blade beside her in bed every night."
Finally, they came to where the troll prince lived, and there the youngest prince received a reception beyond all measure. The troll couldn't think of enough to do for him, for he had slain his master and made him king. He would have gladly given the prince his daughter and half of his land and kingdom. But by now the prince had grown so fond of the youngest of the 12 princesses that he could find no peace. He wanted to set off at once. The troll begged him to remain calm for a little while longer. He told him that the ship would have to sail for almost 7 years before it arrived home. About the princess, the troll said the same as the Griffin.
"As for her, you needn't worry. She places a bare sword blade beside her in bed. If you don't believe me," said the troll, "you can go on board when they sail past here and have a look around while you pick up the sword, for I do need to have it back."
When the ship sailed past, another storm arose, and when the prince went on board, they were all asleep. Each of the princesses lay with her prince, but the youngest of them slept alone with a bare sword blade beside her in bed. On the floor next to her bed lay the Red Knight. The prince took the sword and rowed back to shore without anyone noticing that he'd been on board. But the prince was still restless, and he kept wanting to set off. When the end of the 7 years finally approached, with only 3 weeks remaining, the troll king said,
"Now you can get ready to leave, seeing as you don't wish to stay here with us. You can borrow my iron boat, which travels on its own. All you have to say is, 'Boat, get going!' In the boat you'll find an iron club, which you should hold up when you see the ship appear. Then they'll have such winds that they won't even think to look for you. When you come alongside the ship, hold up the iron club again, and such a storm will arise that they'll have other things to do than keep an eye out for you. When you've passed the ship, hold up the club for a third time, but take care to always put it back down, or else such bad weather will arise that both you and they will perish. When you go ashore, you needn't concern yourself with the boat. Just shove it back in the water, turn it around, and say, 'Boat, go back the way you came.'"
When the prince was ready to leave, he was given heaps of gold and silver and other precious things. along with all the clothing and linen that the troll princess had sewn for him during so many long years. Now he was much richer than any of his brothers. No sooner had he sat down in the boat and said, "Boat, get going," than the boat took off. When he caught sight of the ship right in front of him, he held up the club. Then the winds were so fierce that his brothers forgot to keep an eye out for him. When he came alongside the ship, he once again held up the club. Then there was such a storm and such foul weather that white foam surged around the ship, and the waves washed over the deck. His brothers had other things to think about than looking for him, and when he was past the ship, he held up the club for a third time. Then those on board had enough to do, and there was no time to pay attention to who he might be. The prince reached land long, long before the ship arrived. After he'd taken all his belongings out of the boat, he shoved it back in the water, turned it around, and said, "Boat, go back the way you came." And the boat took off. Then he dressed as a seaman and went up to a wretched hovel where an old woman lived. He convinced her that he was a poor sailor who had been on a big ship that had gone down. He was the only one to survive. Then he asked her if she could offer shelter for both him and the things he had rescued.
"God save me," said the woman. "I can't offer anyone shelter. You can see how things are here, with nowhere to sleep even for me, much less for anyone else."
"Well, that's neither here nor there," said the seaman. If only he had a roof over his head, it didn't matter where he slept. She couldn't very well refuse him shelter when he was willing to put up with what little she could offer. That evening he moved in all his belongings. No sooner were they inside than the old woman, who wanted to hear some news she might share with her neighbors, began asking him what sort of person he was, where he was from, where he'd been, where he was headed, what things he'd brought with him, what the purpose of his journey was, and whether he'd heard anything about the 12 princesses who had disappeared so many years ago. She asked many other questions, too, for there was now plenty of time to discuss and recount. But the seaman told the woman that he was so miserable and had such a bad headache from the vile weather he'd been through that he could hardly think about anything else. She would have to allow him to rest for a few days and recover from all the hardships he'd endured. Then he'd tell her what she wanted to know, and more. The next day the old woman again began to question and pester him, but the seaman still had such a terrible headache from the storm that he couldn't think about anything else. Yet he suddenly let slip a few words. He said that maybe he did know something about the princesses after all. The old woman left at once to tell all the gossip mongers what she'd heard. One after the other, they came running to ask for news of the princesses. Had he seen them? Would they be coming back soon? Were they on their way? And more such questions. But the seaman complained that he had such a headache from the bad weather that he couldn't make sense of anything. Yet this much he did say. If the princesses hadn't perished in the fierce storm that had raged, then they would arrive in 14 days' time, or maybe even sooner. But he couldn't say for certain whether they were still alive. Even though he'd seen them, they might have later gone down with the ship. One of the old women rushed off to the royal palace with the news. She reported that there was a seaman staying in the hovel of a certain old woman, and he had seen the princesses, and they would probably be returning in 14 days' time, or maybe even in 8. When the king heard this, he sent word to the seaman to come and speak to him in person. "I can't go there looking like this," said the seaman. "I don't have the proper clothes to appear before the king." But the king's messenger said he must come. The king wanted and needed to speak to him, no matter how he looked. Until now, no one had ever been able to bring him word of the princesses. So the seaman went to the royal palace and was brought before the king, who asked him if it was true that he had actually seen the princesses. "Yes, I have," said the seaman, "but I don't know whether they are still alive. When I saw them, the weather was so bad that my ship went down. But if they are still alive, they will probably arrive in 14 days' time, or maybe sooner." When the king heard this, he was almost beside himself with joy. As the time approached when the seaman had said his daughters might return, the king put on all his finery and went down to the shore to greet them. There was great joy in all the land when the ship arrived carrying the princesses and the princes and the Red Knight. But no one was happier than the old king, who now had his daughters back. All 11 of the older princesses were also lively and merry, but the youngest of them, who was to have the Red Knight as her husband, wept and was filled with sorrow. The king was not pleased by this. He asked her why she was not merry and cheerful like the other princesses. There was no reason for her to sulk. After all, she had escaped the troll and was to wed a fine man, the Red Knight. She didn't dare say anything, for the Red Knight had warned the princesses that he would kill anyone who recounted what had really happened. But one day, when the princesses were sewing their wedding finery, a man came in wearing a big sailor's coat and carrying a peddler's cupboard on his back. He asked the princesses whether they'd like to buy some of his wares for their wedding. He had many exquisite and precious things, made of both gold and silver. Oh, yes, they'd like to see what he had. They looked at his wares and they looked at him, for they thought they recognized both him and many of the things in his possession.
"A man who has such costly things," said the youngest princess, "must have something that is even more precious, something that would suit us even better."
"That might well be," the peddler said. But the others told her to shush. They reminded her what the Red Knight had threatened to do. One day, a short time later, the princesses were sitting next to the window when the prince again appeared, wearing the big sailor's coat and carrying the cupboard with the golden crowns on his back. When he entered the great hall of the royal palace, he opened the cupboard for the princesses, and each of them recognized her crown. Then the youngest said,
"I think it's only fair that the one who rescued us should have the reward he deserves. That person is not the Red Knight, but this man who has brought back our golden crowns. He was the one who rescued us."
The prince cast off his sailor's coat and stood there looking much more splendid than all the others. So the old king had the Red Knight killed. Only then was there true joy at the royal palace. Each princess married her prince, and news of their weddings spread far and wide throughout 12 kingdoms. The Quandary. There once was a king whose daughter stubbornly talked without ceasing, and no one was able to silence her. So he decreed that anyone who could do so would be given the princess and half the kingdom. 3 brothers heard about this and wanted to try their luck. First to try were the 2 older brothers, who thought they were the most clever. But they made no headway with her, and after that, they were punished. Then Ashlad set off. After he'd gone part way, he found a loop made from a willow bough, and he picked it up. When he'd gone a little farther, he found a broken piece of crockery, and he picked that up, too. When he'd gone farther still, he found a dead magpie, and a short distance away was a twisty goat horn. A bit farther on, he found the matching horn. As he was approaching the royal palace, he walked across the fields where manure had been spread. There he found the worn-out sole of a shoe that had fallen off. All these things he took with him to the royal palace, where he was brought before the princess.
"Good day," he said.
"Good day,"
she said, squirming a bit. "Would you mind if I fried my magpie here?" he asked.
"I'm afraid it would burst," replied the princess.
"Oh, don't worry about that. I'll wrap this loop around it," said the boy, taking out the willow bough.
"The fat will run off it," said the princess.
"I'll hold this underneath," said the boy, showing her the broken piece of crockery.
"You have such a twisty way of talking," said the princess.
"No, I'm not twisty, but this is," he said, taking out one of the horns.
"Well, I've never seen the like," said the princess.
"Here, I'll show you the like," said the boy, and he took out the other goat horn.
"So, are you worn out from trying to silence me?" said the princess.
"No, I'm not worn out, but here's something that is," replied the boy, and he took out the shoe sole. And with that, the princess had no idea what to say. "So, now you're mine," said the boy. Then he was given the princess, along with half the realm and kingdom.
Rich Man, Peddler, Pear. There once was a man they called Rich Man, Peddler, Pear, for he traveled about peddling his wares and had taken in a great deal of money. This had made him a wealthy man. Rich Man, Pear had a daughter, and he was so fond of her that anyone who came to court her was turned away, for he thought none of them was good enough. This happened to all of them, until finally no one came any more, and as the years passed, Pear feared that she would never marry.
"I'm truly puzzled," he said to his wife. "Why does no one come to court our daughter when she is so rich? It would be very strange if no one wanted to marry her. She has plenty of money, and she will have even more. I think I will go and visit the stargazers and ask them who she's meant to marry, for not a soul is coming here."
"How can the stargazers know the answer to that?" asked his wife.
"Oh, they can read everything in the stars," said Rich Man Pear. Taking a great deal of money with him, he set off to see the stargazers. He asked them to look at the stars and tell him which man his daughter was supposed to marry.
The stargazers looked at the stars, but they told him they couldn't see what he wanted to know. So Pear urged them to look harder, and if they told him, he would pay them well. The stargazers looked harder. Then they told him that his daughter would marry the miller's child, who had just been born at the mill, which stood below Rich Man Pear's estate. Pear gave the stargazers $100 for what he had learned and went back home. He thought it unreasonable that his daughter should take as her husband a man who had just come into the world and someone who was of such lowly birth. He said as much to his wife. Then he added,
"I wonder whether they would sell the boy to me. Then we could get rid of him."
"Oh, I'm sure they would," said his wife. "They are poor folks, after all."
So Peddler Pear went down to the mill and asked the woman whether she would sell him her son. If so, he would pay her a great deal of money. No, she wouldn't do it.
"I can't understand why you won't," said Peddler Pear. "I see nothing but misery here, and I doubt very much the boy will make things any easier."
But the woman was very fond of her son, and she didn't want to lose him. When the miller came in, Pear said the same thing to him and promised to give them $600 for the boy. Then they would be able to buy themselves a farm and give up having to grind grain for others or starve when there was no mill water. The miller was pleased with this. He talked to his wife, and then Rich Man Pear was given the boy. The mother wept and carried on, but Pear consoled her by saying that the boy would be treated well. Yet they had to promise not to ask after him, for Pear intended to send him far away to other lands where he would learn foreign languages. When Peddler Pear came home with the boy, he had a small chest made that was so finely crafted it was a pleasure to behold. He filled the cracks with pitch and placed the miller's boy inside. Then he put the lid back on and set the chest in the river, where the current carried it away.
"Now I'm rid of him," thought Peddler Pear.
But when the chest had floated a great distance along the river, it shot into the waterway of another mill. There it got stuck in the water wheel and caused the mill to stop turning. When the man went down to see what had happened to stop the mill, he found the chest and took it back with him. When he came home to his wife at midday, he told her,
"I certainly wonder what could be inside this chest. It came racing down to the water wheel through the mill stream today, and stopped the mill.
Well, we'll soon find out, said his wife. The key is sitting in the lock. Let's open it.
When they opened the chest, they found inside the most beautiful child anyone had ever seen, and they were so happy that they wanted to keep the boy. They had no children of their own, and they were so old by now that they couldn't expect to have any. After some time had passed, Peddler Pear again began to wonder whether anyone would ever come to court his daughter, for she was so rich and had so much money. But no one came. Again he went to see the stargazers, and offered them a great deal of money if they could tell him who his daughter was to marry. "We've already told you that she will marry the miller's boy from below your estate," said the stargazers.
"You may well have said that," Peddler Pear replied. "But something has happened to him, and he's no longer alive. So if I could find out who my daughter will marry, I will gladly give you $200.
The stargazers looked at the stars again, but then they grew angry and said, "Nevertheless, she will marry the miller's boy, the one you set in the river. You hoped to put an end to him, but he is still alive. He is living at the mill that is a certain distance away." Peddler Pear gave them $200 for this prophecy while he pondered how to get rid of the miller's boy. When he got home, the first thing Peddler Pear did was to pay a visit to the other mill. By now the boy was old enough that he had been confirmed. He helped out at the mill, and a handsome lad he was.
"Couldn't you let me have that boy?" Peddler Pear asked the miller.
"No, I can't," he replied. "I've brought him up as my own son. He has turned out so well that now he can be useful and help me at the mill, for I'm starting to grow old and frail."
"Oh, the same thing is happening to me," said Peddler Pear. "That's why I'd like to have someone I could train as a peddler. If you would let me have the boy, I'll give you $600. Then you can buy yourself a farm and spend your old age in peace and quiet."
Well, when the miller heard that, he let Peddler Pear have the boy. The two of them traveled far and wide, peddling their wares, until they came to an inn that stood at the edge of a great forest. From there, Pear sent the boy home with a letter for his wife. It wasn't far through the woods. He told the boy to tell his wife to do what it said in the letter as quickly as possible. The letter said that she should light a big bonfire at once and throw the miller's boy onto it. If she didn't do this, she herself would be burned alive. The boy took the letter and set off through the woods. Toward evening, he came to a farm deep in the forest, and he went inside. He found no one at home, but in one room, a bed had been made up, so he stretched out on top of it. He had stuck the letter in his hatband, and he placed the hat over his face. When the robbers came home, for 12 robbers lived on that farm, they saw the boy lying on the bed. They wondered who he could be. One of them picked up the letter, tore open the envelope, and read what it said.
He said. "This is Peddler Pear's handiwork. Let's play a trick on him. It would be a shame for that old scoundrel to put an end to such a handsome young boy."
So the robbers wrote another letter to Peddler Pear's wife and stuck it back in the hatband while the boy slept. The letter said that she should hold a wedding at once for her daughter and the miller's boy. She should also give them horses and cattle and all manner of tools and set them up properly on the farm that Peddler Pear owned on the mountainside. If this was not done before he arrived home, she would be punished. The next day the robbers sent the boy off. When he came to the peddler's house, he gave the woman the letter. He told her he brought greetings from Peddler Pear, who said she should do what it said in the letter, and as quick as could be.
"You must have served him well for him to write this to me," the peddler's wife told the miller's boy. "When the two of you set off, he was so angry that he couldn't get rid of you fast enough."
Then she held the wedding at once, and set him up with horses and cattle, and all.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.